Hi, I'm Tom Plucinsky from BMW North America, head of BMW Group Classic here in the USA. BMW has had a long history of developing electric vehicles, and we're here in the workshop of the Petersen Museum to show you just three of those special cars from over the years. The beginning of BMW's history in electric vehicles started with a car that looked very much like a 2002, but it was called a 1602. Same body style and everything, and was fully electric. That car was used in 1972 Olympic Games in Munich as the lead vehicle for the cycling events. So it produced no emissions, it was perfect for that. Didn't have much range, didn't have very much horsepower, but it really didn't need it at the time. Now we take a long step forward to 1991 with the car that I have behind me here, the BMW E2 Concept. This was the second of the E concepts. The first was the E1. We built two running prototypes. This was a concept, just a model, actually. In fact, it was designed here at BMW Designworks USA in California, and it was introduced for the first time at the LA International Auto Show in December of 1991. It's a very forward-looking car. If you think back, at that time, BMW was making E30s, quite squarish, angular, upright, and here we have this swoopy electric car. BMW fans will notice certain styling cues that have made their way into regular production vehicles. Yesterday someone said, oh, they saw E39 5 Series in the car. If you look at the taillights, I see some Z3 in there. Wheels, as typical BMW wheels, pushed out to the outside edges for a long wheelbase, better ride, better handling, and also quite wide, if you notice. So even though this is a very small car, it was meant to carry 4 people and also provide the driving dynamics that you would expect from a BMW. This car was planned to have a 45 horsepower engine, not very much. It did 0 to 50 miles per hour in about 16 seconds, so not exactly what today's buyer would want. It was a good test mule for development. And then after the two E1 prototypes were run and went through their cycle of development, the project went on the back burner for a few more years. You may be asking, why is it called the E2? It's a good question. The reason is the E stands for electric, and the 2, it means it's the second version of it. First one was the E1. We built two running prototypes. Those were used for development purposes for several years. The E2, unfortunately, just stayed as a model, but that's the story behind the nomenclature. Some people may not know, but BMW Group owns Mini and Rolls-Royce as additional products within the portfolio. And when BMW was considering going electric, we believed that the Mini brand would be the best to be the start of that new era of electric vehicles. Towards 2008, BMW Group decided to really start focusing on electric mobility once again. It put together a division called BMW I. I stood for innovation. That division started looking at what sort of cars would be needed for the next 10 years or so, what sort of technology exists already for electromobility, and what needed to be developed. This car was designed as a test bed for electric technology in the real world. So 500 of these cars were hand-built, with help from AC Propulsions here in California. So again, another California tie-in. And the cars were converted to be full BEVs, battery electric vehicles, and then leased to customers across the country. But what we wanted from those was data. Data on how people use the vehicles, data on charging, data on how the customers liked or disliked, what they liked and disliked about the cars. All this data we wanted back to feed into the next step of the program. So here we see the business end of the Mini E. The car itself is a regular production Mini Cooper that has had the engine removed and a AC propulsion developed electric motor and controller placed in instead. Again, from a design standpoint, it's a standard Mini Cooper, first generation. However, all the Mini E's had the electric yellow accents on it, and the Mini written down the side, and it culminates with the stylized electric plug where the fuel door is, and inside the fuel door is a charging plug. Car had about 100 miles of range, not a very big battery pack, and we wanted to see if 100 miles was enough, what people thought of it. And in fact, we had one Mini that was driven for over 60,000 miles. On the interior, it is also a production level Mini. However, it does have many details that are specific to the Mini E, with the electric yellow on the dash, with the stylized plug, as well as the stitching. The dash, however, is mostly production level, but the instrument cluster in front of the driver has specific things for electric driving, including the range and the power available. As we look into the rear seat area, we see where the compromises were. This was a conversion car. So in other words, it was an internal combustion type car prior. And in order to fit everything that needed to be fit in it, we had to lose the rear seats, unfortunately, in the car. It's only got a 35 kilowatt hour battery in it, but it takes up a ton of room. After this initial test program with customers, the cars were brought back into BMW and torn down. This is one of the last survivors of it and was kept in our museum in Spartanburg, South Carolina. The customers who had these cars could move into the next development car for another short-term lease, and that was called the ActiveE. That used a new generation of motor, new generation of battery pack, which was the basis for actually the car that we have here. Now, it may not be the easiest car to recognize at this point because all its skin is taken off, but this is the i3 that came out in 2014. The BMW i3 was the culmination of all the work that Project I did. BMW felt that it was necessary to develop our own electric motor, and this is the first car to have BMW's own electric motor in it. Second thing is the battery pack was very important to the overall dynamics of the car, so BMW brought the development of the battery pack in-house. And you could reduce the size of the battery pack for the same range if you were able to make the car lighter. So that allowed us to experiment with things like carbon fiber and aluminum. The car had about 100 miles range when initially launched, which from our research with previous cars seemed to be enough for most customers. But it was able to give 100 miles range in comfort for four passengers because it was lightweight. It was under 3,000 pounds, which for an electric car is really, really light. BMW went to the length to produce its own carbon fiber for this and did it sustainably up in Washington State. As BMW was industrializing carbon fiber production, it didn't make sense to build carbon fiber cars the way supercars are made, for example, where something is hand laid up and then put in an autoclave, a big pressure cell, heating pressure cell that cooks the structure in one shot. For this car, it was done in components and then they're glued together. The advantage of that is collision repair was very easy. You can cut out a section. We made insert sections that you could glue back in, and the i3 was back on the road with the same rigidity that it had before. The car was first introduced in 2014 and it stayed in production until 2021. And in that period of time, its battery pack couldn't grow. However, the battery capacity, so the specific energy of that battery pack more than doubled over that period of time. So that just shows how much battery technology was advancing. 7 years, double the range. You may have noticed the wheels and tires on the car look a little odd. If you see that they're quite narrow and quite tall. But the reason it was done was for rolling resistance. The lower the rolling resistance, the less energy you're putting through the tires and losing to the tire and road. So energy is everything. From a design standpoint, the i3 also has a tie to the US market and specifically to California. BMW Design Works was again the lead on the design of the car, and one of its young designers was the lead exterior designer for the model. I hope you enjoyed this deep dive of some really special BMWs that started the electrification of BMW vehicles in the market. These were three good ones. We have one more I can show you up on another floor. Follow me. I promised one more car to show you, and that is the BMW Vision EfficientDynamics. If you look at the car, you may recognize it. It became the i8, but initially it was designed specifically to show some of the technology that was going into the i3. As an example, the electric motor that is on the front axle of the EfficientDynamics is the motor from the i3, and that was supplemented by a gasoline engine at the rear of the car, producing another 200 horsepower. So total you had 350 horsepower in a quite a lightweight car, also carbon fiber shell, and it was just designed initially as a showpiece. So this was a very early car. This particular example was used in the Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol movie. So it is a non-runner. However, a one runner was made and then it developed into the i8, and there were several i8 concepts before the final production one arrived in the market. Again, to great critical success, it's still a gorgeous car today, and it was the precursor of all the technology that went into the i3. My name is Tom Plucinsky. Thank you for joining us.